Hi everyone, thank you for checking us out on our video sermon. Before you hear the message for this week, I'd like to let you know that our conference is coming up this year at the end of August. We have invited a host of speakers that we really believe is going to be a big blessing to you. This year, we are going to talk about this idea called space, the space in our lives, the space with God, our space with people. The inability to handle these spaces has caused us a lot of anxiety and problem in our society today. And we hope that through this conference, we can restore that so that you can move from fear to faith and creating a future for others. So do check us out at our website and yep, enjoy the video sermon.
So 2 weeks ago, Pastor started this series on the Word. He talked about how prayer and Word, they are intimately related, right? He said, if you want to hear the voice of God, if you want to hear God speak to you, you must first learn the Word. You must first understand the Word of God. So today, I want to continue on with this series by sharing with you a few important yet practical usage of God's Word, especially in this era that we live in the 21st century. Are you ready? Yes, let us pray. Father, we just want to thank you for this time. We thank you, Lord, for your presence in this place. Lord, we love your word. And I pray today, as I speak forth your message, Lord, this word will go into the hearts of your people and start taking roots, God. Lord, you will reveal your heart to us and your plans in our life. Father, we just commit this whole time to you. In Jesus' name we pray. And all of God's people say, amen. Amen. Can I just tell you a story before we start? So this was back in high school. I was in the school band. I used to play the French horn. Some of you say, wow, this small girl can play French horn. That's true. So I played French horn for 5 years. And so there was once we won the marching competition. Back then, this marching competition, very famous one. You know, all the schools would compete in a national level. So we won. And because of that, we had the opportunity to go for an international music festival. Cool, right? Hey, come on, give me some response. Y'all got go international music festival or not? So pretty cool lah. But that was also the first time that I was going to leave home and my family, you know, for more than a week. Some of you say, che, you know, I also study overseas, no, what's family? But wow, that time, I don't know why, very easily get homesick. So on the day when we were about to depart, you know, going to the airport, I just suddenly was so overwhelmed with missing my family. I think my mom felt it and she probably feel the same way as well. So she came and gave me a hug, you know, and she said, hey, don't worry lah, you know, you got enough money, right? Take good care of yourself, okay? Look out for your friends, you know? Don't worry lah, enjoy yourself. Everything's going to be okay. You know, moms being mom, right? They tell you like that. Wow, I cannot help it. I just started crying. And all my friends who saw me, must be such awkward moment. You know, till today, I still have this weakness for farewells and goodbyes. I go for people's farewell party, right? Not they cry, I cry, you know. When they give farewell speech, I cry. Very weird. I went to Mount KK once. I think my husband would remember this. Back then, we were still boyfriend, girlfriend. You know, this guy who carries your bag, the portals, so they follow you up the mountain and come down, right? By the time we were saying goodbye, right, I was sobbing, like, bye, bye, bye. I don't know why. And we went to Korea, you know, for holidays. Saying goodbye to the tour guide is like, ayo, like, I don't know why, but I just kept crying. And there are many, many embarrassing moments like that. So my point here really is, you know, if you think about some of these moments where you are departing or, you know, when you're about to part ways with a loved one or someone who is very dear, important to you, their words become even more so compelling, right? The simple words like, take good care. You really feel, wow, I need to have that urgency and that desire to really want to take good care and do something about my life, right? Now, this is probably how Timothy felt when Paul wrote him the final and most personal letter. And Paul was in the midst of his trial and probable execution. This letter must have been Timothy's most prized possession, that he has kept it so well preserved, right? And he has passed on from generation to generation until this very day we read it in the Bible. Now, let's take a deep dive into Paul's letter, shall we? If you go to your Bible or it's on the screen in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 10 to 13. And this is the key passage we're going to study this morning. It says, but you, Timothy, certainly know what I teach and how I live and what my purpose in life is. You know my faith, my patience, my love, my endurance. You know how much persecution and suffering I have endured. You know all about how I was persecuted in Antioch, Iconium, and Lystra. Now, if you read the story of Paul's mission trips, this was his very first mission trip. And when he was there preaching the gospel, he created such an uproar in the city. You know, people were rejecting God. So they came, they stoned him, they dragged him out of the city and left his lifeless body by the roadside. But the Lord rescued me from it. Yes, and everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. But evil people and imposters will flourish. They will deceive others and will themselves be deceived. In verse 14 and verse 15, I want you to take note of this. But you must remain faithful. Everyone say, remain faithful. To the things that you have been taught, you know they are true, for you know you can trust those who taught you. You have been taught the Holy Scriptures from childhood, and they have given you the wisdom to receive the salvation that comes by trusting in Christ Jesus. Friends, Paul made it clear that following Jesus will come with persecution. Come on, turn to your neighbor and say, persecution. But we must remain faithful to the Scripture. And I love the worship this morning and how Jin Choong was talking about how God is so faithful. He will stand on His promises. He will never abandon us. And if we expect God to be faithful, shouldn't God expect us to be faithful as well, right? God's word enables us to withstand persecution. So when we think about this word persecution, what comes to your mind? You know, usually we think about, oh, those Christians who are living in fear. You know, their lives are being threatened, missionaries who go abroad and they are being martyred, churches being burned down. Today with technology, we also see churches being bombed to ashes. Now, we are very fortunate that we don't suffer from such violence in this part of our world. But our persecution may come in other forms. Every single day, if you think about it, we are faced with a choice to live by God's way or our way. Amen? Yes? You know, once we were traveling in Thailand, and my brother rented this car. So for the family, you know, to go around the city, we visited Khao Yai. It's a beautiful place. So one night, we were driving and, you know, back to the resort. We had such a wonderful day. We've gone for cafe hoppings. We've taken a lot of nice pictures. So we had so much fun. We were singing in the car. We were very happy, not drunk, okay, just happy. And all of a sudden, I don't know where the tree came from, you know, and my brother just hit a tree. Bam! Whoa! All of us stunned in the car, like, what just happened? So, you know, being the comforting one, right, I went down, quickly checked. Hey, I think it's okay, lah. You see, just light scratches on it. Very little bump, nothing, lah, nothing serious. And my husband, being the brutally honest one, took out his flashlight. No, lah. You see, so obvious. You see the bump, can see one, you know, cannot miss. So, you know, we all chip in, lah. Everyone started panicking. Like, ayo, what should we do? What should we do? And then the question came, should we tell the car rental company? Friends, five adult Christians who have gone through, children church training, that you should tell the truth at all costs, right? Do not lie, right? But we here, we are struggling. Should we tell, should we not? I just want you to ask your neighbor a bit. Like, let's just have some interaction. If you were in that situation like we did, what would you do? Would you admit or would you lie about it? Come on. Tell the truth, huh? The truth will set you free. Ask your neighbor. What would you do? Ah, you're tough. Why such a struggle, huh? So is anyone going to lie? Okay, don't need a raise hand, never mind. So friends, if we can even struggle with such minor accident, you know, what are some of the things that we go through, the internal conflicts or the dilemma that we struggle through to keep our faith? Yeah? These are some common ones that we heard as we grow up as Christians, or there could be could be many more. For example, love your enemy. I mean, like, who can love your enemy? I remember having a very bad breakup, right, many years ago. I used very strong language yesterday, like, in the service, but today, because got recording, I try to tone down. I tell you, every single day, I think of getting him to pay back, you know, like, walao, this guy hurt my feelings. How to love your enemy? But the Bible say, pray for them. Forgive those who hurt you. Isn't it amazing? The Bible says, refrain from gossips and foul languages. Wow, how, you know, when you're going through such a difficult time with your boss and the whatever words wants to come out, how do I refrain my tongue? Life and death lies in the power of your tongue, right? Rejoice in someone's success rather than being envious. So last year, I remember going back to the office after having my maternity break, and you know, we were thinking, okay, there's some restructuring that's gone on. You know, I've done a great job previously. So I was looking forward to a promotion. But instead of being given a promotion, my colleague was given an advanced promotion. I tell you, at that time, I was overwhelmed with so much emotions. I just couldn't look her in the eye to congratulate her. Christian, you know. Christian who is supposed to be rejoicing in other people's success. And I had to go back, you know, and really come to repentance and say, God, help me to deal with this emotion. I confessed a soul out to my husband, so he was my counselor at that time. Like, it's okay, you know, we move on, we rejoice. And of course, I went back after that to congratulate her. But all these struggles are real, isn't it? Come on, don't look at me like, you know, I'm an alien. We all go through challenges in deciding, right? If we want to follow God's way or our own way. Or young people, you know, you hear this all the time. Remain a virgin, consecrate yourself, set your heart pure before you get married, right? Until you get married. But this is what the world tells us otherwise. You know, you can go sleep around, it's okay. Or when you're married, you know, stay loyal in your marriage. Who says after you get married, you don't get attracted to the other person, right? So how do you stay loyal? And have integrity, be truthful despite the consequences, just like how I've shared with you the story of the car accident. And there are many, many more. Clearly, my friends, God's way is very different from our way or the world's way. And more often than not, it requires us to make unpopular decisions. Yeah? In Isaiah chapter 55, verse 8 to 9, the verse says, "My thoughts are nothing like your thoughts, says the Lord, and my ways are far beyond anything you could imagine. For just as the heavens are higher than the earth, so my ways are higher than your ways, and my thoughts higher than your thoughts." Matthew chapter 7, verse 13 to 14, and this really got me thinking about my own life. If you can enter God's kingdom only through the narrow gate, the highway to hell is broad, and its gate is wide for the many who choose that way. But the gateway to life, I want to say the gateway to life, is very narrow, and the road is difficult, and only a few ever find it. Church, by now, I hope you understand that following Jesus involves inviting tension and discomfort into our lives because we choose the path that very few are willing to take. And that is why we need the Word of God. We need the Word of God to affirm our faith so that we do not give up or give in to persecution. Can I hear an amen for that? So God's Word enables us to withstand persecution. Now, Paul goes on to say in chapter 3, verse 16, and many of us would know this passage. It says, "All scripture is inspired by God and is useful to teach us what is true and to make us realize what is wrong in our lives. It corrects us when we are wrong and teaches us to do what is right. God uses it to prepare and equip His people to do every good work." And if you read in the NKJV version, it says, "All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work." So in this passage, Paul reminds Timothy that the scripture is beneficial, but not just as a moral compass, it is a way of life. So if you want to know how to live your life the Word of God is your best reference point. God's Word equips us to do good work. Now, the passage started by saying all Scripture is inspired by God. So while I was preparing this, you know, I asked Pastor Andrew, hey, Pastor Andrew, can you make me look a bit smarter on stage, you know, like introduce some Greek terms. So instead of giving me the answer, he gave me more Bible commentaries. Praise the Lord. So anyway, I found this, okay? So Paul uses this Greek term. It sounds like a dinosaur name. It goes Theopneustos, Theopneustos, which means God breathed. So basically, the Word of God is God's breath. Yeah, God. Although God uses His people to write His Scripture, but the ultimate origin is God Himself, and the Scripture is used to teach His truth, to rebuild those in sin, to correct those in error, and to train new believers in His way. And therefore, there's only one way for us to study the Word of God, and that is to accept the entire truth. Amen? Now, if you're thinking, is there an a la carte option? I'm sorry, there's no a la carte option in the Word of God. You take it whole, the whole Word. And, you know, this got me thinking, and I must thank Jin Chong and Inha for this. So I thank Inha yesterday. I say, wow, I don't know what do y'all do to inspire or convince or persuade my husband. Lately, he's been very on, you know, in terms of going for CrossFit. So he never wakes up like early in the morning one. His earliest maybe, I don't know, in the afternoon. But he wakes up 6 a.m., he gets himself ready, 7 o'clock, he's out, CrossFit training, comes back at 8, takes a shower and goes to work. I really don't know how he does it. Every time he comes back, ayo, dear, jelly, like so tired, cannot feel my hand, but tomorrow I'm going again. Wow. So thank you, Jin Chong. I hope he also gets built like you someday. But anyway, that's not the point. The point is I learned a few tips from, you know, trying to stay healthy. The best way to reach an optimum weight, there are three elements to it, okay? The first one is to eat right. I'm sure most of you would have heard it, right? Secondly is to exercise, the thing that we hate the most. And lastly, this is something that a lot of people miss. If you want to reach an optimum weight, you need to sleep. Wow. Now, let me break it down for you, okay? If you eat right without exercising, well, still can work like initially, you know, you still lose some weight, but you'll never be able to gain the muscles to burn those fats eventually. So the fats still stay in your body. If you exercise without eating right, so every time you go for an intensive workout, then you go for buffet. Can also lie, you know, some point you still lose some weight, but you will never get the good nutrition to sustain your health, right? Or if you eat right, you exercise, but you don't sleep. Now, your organs will never be in their best shape to rejuvenate or to recharge your body. To be truly fit, we need all three elements. Amen? And this is the same with the Word of God. We need to embrace the entire Scripture. Whether or not they are pleasing to our ears, whether we like this passage or not, or I can understand this passage or not, we need to embrace the entire Word of God because it is from Him and it serves a purpose to equip us. So how should we treat the Word of God? Well, I guess the least we can do is to develop a spiritual habit of reading our Bible. Amen? And when we were younger, you know, I go to children's church and the teachers will always teach us to sing, read your Bible, pray every day. Yes, some of you are smiling. You know we are from the same era. Praise the Lord. So we learn, you know, to read the Bible and pray. And those were when we were kids. But they never teach you how to read the Bible when you're going through difficult times. How to read the Bible, you know, when you just lost a child. Or how do you read the Bible when you're going through financial crisis or when a relationship is broken? You know, we grow up with such, carrying such burdens in our hearts. And how do the Word of God become relevant to our lives? Now, perhaps you say, okay, maybe I'm not going through all that. But nowadays, I have so many commitments. How do I start reading the Word? Well, for me, you know, ever since having a kid and a demanding job and a never-ending house chores, setting aside time to read the Bible has become more challenging than ever. So the best time for me is really to do it while I'm traveling in the car. So this is what I do. I will turn on my Bible app. I will set it on audio mode. I'm so thankful for the words that says, you know, faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. So that's how I learn the word. I hear the word of God when I commute to work. And when I reach the office, I'll take 5 to 10 minutes just to think about what I've hear from the Bible app and say a prayer. And you'll be surprised how God can use these moments to speak to you. You know, I will get promptings to remember somebody or to text somebody. You know, so I'll just quickly write them a text, say, how are you? I'm just praying for you. Hope everything is okay. Friends, that's putting word into action. Amen? Now, what would you do to equip yourself with the word? How would you get yourselves ready for the word of God? The good thing is, because we're living in the 21st century, right? God's word is more accessible today than before. Now, I know some of you take the MRT to work or you take a Grab because today's traffic is just unpredictable. So instead of using the time in the car to scroll through your Facebook, you know, or your Instagram account, I don't know, nowadays people say Facebook is for our parents. Thank God I'm a parent, so I still fall in that category. So instead of using those time to scroll through your social media, why don't tune into God's word? And my sister introduced me to this wonderful app. She said, you know, if you want to see visuals, you want it a bit more animation, you want storytelling, go check out the Bible Project. That's a good way to start loving the word of God and learning God's word. If you're a little bit more retro like me, I love documentaries. So that's where you can also learn the word of God. Now, if you are finding yourself, you know, on a weekday when you get home, you're sitting at your sofa and you are beginning a marathon of TV series on Netflix, I tell you, Netflix is a wonderful creation. I don't know why I only discovered it recently. Seriously, like Netflix, but actually that's not the sermon point, okay? Netflix is just a wonderful tool, right, for you to just relax and spend time with your husband, watching some nice mindless movies. But if you find yourself going through a marathon, why don't you sign up for Ruma Bible Study class? You know, if you can go through hours and hours and hours, you know, not taking a time to pee, you have the resilience to go through Ruma. Or you can just start off by coming next Tuesday, okay, for the church-wide Bible study. Amen? Can I see a show of hands? How many of you are coming next Tuesday? Promise, okay? Recorded. Now, students, what about, you know, we always have to wait for the next class. You know, we are always, like, in this waiting game. Why not turn on the collective app? You know, the staff team have put in wonderful resources on devotion. That's the best way for us to start reading the Word of God. And if you're a parent and you're always wondering what to do with my kids, they're always so hyper-energetic, don't know what to do with them. You know, make reading the Word of God a pastime for them or a bedtime routine for your kids. Expose them to the Word of God when they are still young. Amen? The Word of God ought to be in our hearts, not on our bookshelf or not under our pillows. This way, we can be ready for every good work. But when the Bible says for every good work, what does it mean? Good works here means to respond to the needs of our world. Today, if you just look around, if you go back to the office, you know, if you go back to your neighborhood, there are plenty of needs in our world. You know, if someone were to come up to you to say, hey, Jacqueline, I'm not feeling well, you know, I'm sick. You know, are you ready to pray for that person? Are you ready to encourage that person? Today, we hear of so many people going through depression, you know, stress. How are we going to support them or encourage them? You know, do we know the ethics to excel in the marketplace or the right values to build family, healthy family units or to serve our church and our community? Friends, we need the Word of God. We need the Word of God to strengthen our faith so that we will have the ability and the confidence to carry out God's good work on earth. Are you still with me? Yes? And so finally, Paul closes his letter by saying in chapter 4, verse 1 to 5, I solemnly urge you in the presence of God and Christ Jesus, who will someday judge the living and the dead when he comes to set up his kingdom, preach the word of God. Be prepared whether the time is favorable or not. Patiently correct, rebuke, and encourage your people with good teaching. For a time is coming when people will no longer listen to sound and wholesome teaching. They will follow their own desires and will look for teachers who will tell them whatever their itching ears want to hear. They will reject the truth and chase after myth. But you should keep a clear mind in every situation. Again, don't be afraid of suffering for the Lord. Work at telling others the good news and fully carry out the ministry that God has given you. So imagine this with me. Paul is writing his final words. It's like his will, you know, before he goes off. And instead of telling him, you know, how great he has done in ministry, what are the great works he has accomplished, he charges Timothy ahead to preach the gospel. And in this passage alone, he didn't only say it once, he said it three times. Friends, God's word empowers us to preach the good news. Now, I know when I say good news, some of you are thinking, what kind of good news can we be having, you know, in the times that we're living in? And the Bible describes many events that will mark the end of the world. You know, if you read in the book of Revelations or many other books in the Bible, it talks about the different incidences or events that will eventually take place. And people commonly refer to this period as the last days. Have you heard of that? Yes. Now, I know we nowadays we have all these movies on apocalypse, and it talks of zombie, human mutation, and the world just kaboom, you know, explodes and splits apart, you know, and that's how the world will end. Well, some of which may be true, some of which are just fictional. So let's see what the Bible says, okay? These are just some of the last days prophecies which are found in the Bible. The Bible talks about war on a large scale. And today we are already seeing, you know, many unrest in different countries which are fighting with each other, especially in the Middle East. And lately, even in the modern days, we are hearing the Huawei trade war. Are you all following the news? I don't know what's up with US and, you know, China. Like, they have nothing else to do but to create a war. You know, we hear of famine, we hear of earthquakes, tsunami, all these natural disasters, or some of you may have heard them as malapetaka. Still remember that word, right? Pestilences, sicknesses that are spreading across the nation, increase of crimes, ruining of the earth by mankind. Some of the news you have heard, you know, people dumping plastics in our backyard. Like, how can that happen? Deterioration of people's attitude. Paul emphasizes that in the last days, people will be lovers of themselves. Breakdown of family units, children who will be rebellion, and people who will reject God and live godless lives. No doubt, my friends, we are living in the last days. But it is not without hope. Can I see some hope in your faces? Why? Because Jesus will come back again. The word says Jesus will come back again and he will establish his kingdom on this earth. Amen? And what will he do? He will restore all things. Now, Jesus is going to restore earth. He's going to restore his ruling and governance. And most importantly, he will restore his relationship with us. And therefore, our future is secure. Why don't you turn to your neighbor and say, my future and your future is secure. Turn to your neighbor behind you and say, your children's future is secure. You know, our generation's future is secure. Amen? Come on, aren't you excited? Yes. So what then is our duty as believers today? We are not to sit and wait in terror, you know, for all the bad things to happen. But we are here to preach the good news. Amen? You know, if the world have heard about Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., they should now hear about the marvelous agent of Christ. Come on. Can we give God a big hand for that? We need to preach the word of God. But the big question here is, why don't we preach the word? Human being humans, we will always come back with 1,001 excuses. I'll just share with you the top three. You know, we say, I don't know enough of the Word of God. I don't know what to say if they were to ask me tough questions. Well, that's what you think, but let's hear what the Word says. The Word says in John chapter 4, verse 26, well, when the Father sends the Advocate as my representative, that is the Holy Spirit, He will teach you everything and He will remind you of everything I have told you. Every single week when you go for Connect Group, when you are seated in the hall, you know, in the main services, the Word of God is being preached to you. You will remember the Word of God. In Luke chapter 12, verse 11 to 12, don't worry about how to defend yourself or what to say, for the Holy Spirit will teach you at the time what needs to be said. Then some of you may say, okay, I think I can deal with the lack of Bible knowledge. But what if I get rejected? What if they start laughing at me and think that I'm weird? Well, in John chapter 15, verse 18, the Bible says, if the world hates you, remember that it hated me first. The world doesn't reject you. The world rejects God. In Isaiah 50, verse 7, because the sovereign Lord helps me, I will not be disgraced. Therefore, I have set my face like a stone, determined to do His will. And I know that I will not be put to shame. Amen? The last ultimate excuse. You know, after we have said all this and the Bible has a word to defend that, I'm too busy lah. I don't have the time to share the gospel. In Matthew chapter 9, verse 35 to 38, praise God for His word, right? There's always answers to everything. Jesus traveled through all the towns and villages of that area, teaching in the synagogues and announcing the good news about the kingdom. And He healed every kind of disease and illness. When He saw the crowd, He had compassion on them. Can we all say compassion? Because they were confused and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. He said to the disciples, the harvest is great, but the workers are few. So pray to the Lord who is in charge of the harvest. Ask Him to send more workers into His fields. 2,000 years ago, Jesus has already confirmed that the needs are great in our world. And all He needs now is the manpower, the resources who will deploy His good news. And we really don't have to be all spiritual and religious, you know, about sharing the gospel. Start by having compassion. Start by paying attention to the needs around you, to the people around you, right? Start by sharing your story. In fact, in this 21st century, the internet has become our mission field. You know, just with a click of a button, we can already reach out and share God's love. The people and the places who needs to hear the gospel are pretty much within your fingertips. I just want to share with you this story. You know, some years ago, a group of us, we got a chance to go to Medan for missions. And it was great, you know, we got to preach in the small groups, we got to preach in the main services, but nothing was more memorable than this, preaching to a group of mentally ill patients. I mean, if you were in that situation, I mean, how do you connect with people who have very different wavelength in terms of mental capacity? You know, in your world today, in your workplace, or when you're in with your family members, or when you're among your friends, not everyone shares our belief, right? Not everyone shares the same faith. But how do we connect with them? Now, if it was not for the Word of God, we would never be able to connect with these people, let alone lead them to Christ. The Word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword. It's able to touch and transform every single living being, be it our family, our friends, our classmates, our lecturers, our bosses, the people that we think are impossible for God to touch them. God can touch and transform them. The auntie across the road, you know, the stranger sitting next to you in a train, or the Grab driver who's bringing you to your destination, the hairstylist or the, you know, the hair salon that is serving you. All we need to do, my friend, is to preach the good news. Now, in his final words, Paul recognized that his time is short. You know, he's coming to the end of his days. He said in verse 6 to verse 8, as for me, my life has already been poured out as an offering to God. The time of my death is near. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race, and I have remained faithful. And now the prize awaits me, the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on the day of his return. And the prize is not just for me, but for all who eagerly look forward to this appearing. This promise is not just for Timothy. This promise is also for you and me, those who remain faithful in doing the word of God. Now, think about this for a moment. If you had a crystal ball, or if you could travel through time, and you know that you have very limited time to live, how would you live your life? Would you live it the same way, or would you do it differently? Sometimes, coming to the end of our life makes us realize that life is much more than just pursuing our careers, or looking after our family, making more money, or having more material possessions. I'm not saying that we cannot do all those, but there are more important things that God has given to us. And while we have a future that we can look forward to, let us not forget the people around us who have not heard about the loving grace of God. I want to end my message today with the final words of Jesus. So you've heard the final words of Paul to Timothy, right? This is the mandate. I charge you to go and preach the gospel. And the same way, Jesus gives us his final words in Matthew 28, verse 18 to 20. He says, I have been given all authority in heaven and on earth. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age. Church, Jesus is calling every single one of us, Christians, believers, not just leaders of the church, not just your CG leader, not just people who know the word a bit more than you. He's calling every single one of us to step out in faith and to preach the good news. This is the Great Commission, and this is word in action. Now, will you do your part to respond to this call?
Thank you for checking out our online sermon. If the message has truly impacted and empowered your life, it is my desire that you sow into the work of our church so that you can partner with us as we continually reach out to our world for Jesus Christ and extend the arms of love of Christ. So if you're giving, you can give online, or you can do a direct transfer, and all the information that you need is on the screen. So God bless you, and thank you for partnering with us.